Hello and welcome. In this session, we shall deal with UDIN for bank audit. For this purpose, let us visit the UDIN site of ICAI, udin.ica.org. If you are not yet registered in this site, you may go to first time setup and you can register yourself. Once the registration is done, you can log in by giving your credentials. Thereafter, give the captcha and log in. We are into this. Since you are carrying out the statutory bank branch audit, you have to select the audit and assurance function. Generation of UDIN for audit and assurance function is mandatory from 1st July 2019. You have to select the type of audit. It is statutory audit branch. Thereafter, you have to select the regulation or the act under which you are carrying out the audit. It is Banking Regulation Act 1949. Section 30 of Banking Companies Regulation Act states that the profit and loss account prepared in accordance with section 29 shall be audited by a person duly qualified under any law for the time being in force to be an auditor of companies. And the next subsection states that notwithstanding anything contained in any law for time being in force or in any contract to the contrary, every banking shall, before appointing, reappointing or removing any auditor or auditors, obtain the previous approval of the Reserve Bank of India. That's why the auditor's list is sent to the Reserve Bank of India for approval before you get the actual appointment letters. Now you have to give the date on which the reports or certificates are being signed. You have 6 points which have to be populated, and if you wish to give any other figures, then you can click on add more. This add more can be done and any number of points can be given here. But is there any limit for that? Well, I have tried for 100 items and thereafter I did not try. So I can assure you that you can add at least 100 of the items. If you want to remove them, then any of the item which have been added, you can select delete last row. Now the financial year has to be populated. Of course, for the year 1920, we have to populate it as 1/4/2019 to 31/3/2020. PAN number of the SSE is to be given. This item is not a mandatory field as asterisk mark does not appear before this item number. So where the PAN number is not available readily with the branch, you can skip this item. Thereafter, you have to give the gross turnover or gross receipt. What do you mean by gross turnover or gross receipt? We shall deal at a later point of time in our discussion. Thereafter, fourth point requires us to populate shareholders' funds or owners' funds. Since we are dealing with the branch audit, generally this amount will be zero. Zero will be appearing in the balance sheet against shareholders' funds. Next item to be populated is net block of property, plant and equipment. This is nothing but fixed assets, net fixed assets, which will be appearing on the asset side of the balance sheet of the branch which you are auditing. Now, mind you, the term used is net block. So net block implies that it is net of depreciation. You will also have the statement of depreciation or schedule for fixed assets and depreciation, wherein you have the net amount as on the year end, that is 31st March, and it should tally with the fixed assets figure in the asset side of the balance sheet. Thereafter, you have to give the firm registration number. Now, what is the case, and mind you, this sixth point is a mandatory field. So what if you are appointed as an auditor in your individual capacity instead of your firm? Then what is to be filled? That thing also we will deal at a later point of our discussion. Now, Document description. Do not disclose client details. So what you can write here? You can very well write that it is a statutory bank branch audit for financial year 2019-20. And there is something called as remarks, internal reference note or remarks. This will not be shown to the authority. So when the authority check for the UDIN, this information which has been provided will not be disclosed to that authority who have searched the UDIN. So in such a case, you may very well write the branch which you have audited for your future reference. Now thereafter, what you have to do is you have to ask for send OTP. Once you have filled all the compulsory fields, you should click on send OTP, wherein the OTP will be sent to your registered mobile and email. After populating the OTP received, the UDIN will be generated. Now, certain items we have kept pending for discussion at a later point of time. Now, do you have any guidance from ICA with regard to the items of figures that have to be provided here? Now, what I will do is, I will just log out for a minute. In the homepage of UDIN website, there is something called as frequently asked questions, unique documentation identification number UDIN. If you click on this, you can download the frequently asked questions. I have readily kept this publication with me on my desktop. And if you refer to chapter 6 of this publication, it deals with audit and assurance function. Of course, these are FAQs wherein you can go through the items one by one, but I will directly go to the point of interest which we require as of now. Now, in these questions, question number 58, firm registration number is a compulsory field. What should I write in case there is no FRN? Now, the guidance is given that if a member is practicing in his or her individual name and there is no FRN, member can mention NA or not applicable at the place of FRN. It is a compulsory field, and if you are doing practice in your individual name, then note NA or not applicable in that field. Now, the financial year or period of audit is clear to us, and the shareholders' funds or owners' fund in respect of a branch is nil. That is also clear to us. Now, coming to the item of gross turnover or gross receipts, what is to be mentioned in this column? Under the keywords gross turnover or gross receipts, figures appearing under the gross turnover or gross income or gross proceeds or gross earnings or gross receipts or gross sales or gross revenue, etc., is to be mentioned irrespective of the terms used in the financial statements. Now, in the context of audit of a branch of a bank, in my personal view, what I think is, you have the profit and loss account. In that profit and loss account, you have the income side. And in my view, the total of the income side of the profit and loss account of the branch can be mentioned here. Now, coming to the next item, what is to be included in net block of property, plant and equipment? We already dealt with that. It should be net of depreciation. So this is also mentioned in the FAQs given by the ICA. After depreciation is to be mentioned irrespective of the terms used in the financial statements. Now, moving forward, in the UDIN website, you have something called as frequently asked questions, and in that, we have something called as revised frequently asked questions on bank audit, wherein certain clarifications has been given. Now, the first FAQ deals with whether separate UDINs are required to be generated for LFAR, tax audit, statutory audit report, etc. Now, it has been clarified that since UDIN has to be generated per assignment, per signatory on a given date, so one UDIN will suffice for bank audit report, including LFAR and certificates. Now, let us say you are signing 30 certificates. If you want to mention the amounts or figures of those certificates, what you can do is you can add number of points, and for each certificate, you can include that figure in that particular point. As previously discussed, to my knowledge, even 100 number of points can be included. However, separate UDIN will be required for a tax audit report being a separate assignment. So in the context of audit of a branch of a bank, for LFAR and all other certificates you are signing, one UDIN will suffice. And if you are also conducting the tax audit for that branch, what you have to do is for tax audit report, a separate UDIN has to be generated. But this tax audit UDIN has to be generated in a separate column. That is, the nature of the assignment differs. We will visit that once again. Now, coming to the second one, under bank audit, whether separate UDINs have to be generated for certificates signed. As already discussed, certificates are part of a bank audit assignment and are issued with bank audit report along with LFAR. One UDIN will suffice and no separate UDINs are required to be generated for certificates. That means for one branch, for LFAR and certificates, one UDIN. For one branch, tax audit, another UDIN. So for each branch, you can generate two UDINs. Now, moving forward to the next question. In case of certificates or reports issued under bank audit or signed on different dates, whether separate UDIN will have to be required. Let us say a proprietor is carrying out the audit of a branch on, let us say, yesterday, or for example, today, some 10 certificates have been verified, examined, and they have been finalized and signed. And the rest of the certificates were examined and signed on the next day. So what you have to do is, on a particular date, that is today, for the certificates which have been signed today, one UDIN has to be generated. And the first certificates which have been signed tomorrow, another UDIN has to be generated. Now, the next question deals with, if some certificates or reports is signed by one partner while others are signed by another partner, whether different UDIN is required for each such partner. Now, let us assume that today 10 certificates are examined by one partner and 10 certificates are examined and signed by another partner. Now, in such case, for the 10 certificates signed by partner one, one UDIN has to be generated, and for 10 certificates examined and signed by another partner, another UDIN has to be signed, because UDIN has to be generated by an individual chartered accountant in his login. Now, the next question is whether UDIN is applicable to both statutory central auditors as well as statutory branch auditors. Yes, it is applicable to both of them. The question is answered like, yes, UDIN is applicable to both statutory central auditors and statutory branch auditors for bank, branch audit report and tax audit reports while conducting the bank branch audit or the bank audit. Now, whether UDIN is mandatory for bank audit report and tax audit report, that is, or filed online using digital signature. Now, these days, some banks are asking for digital signatures, and some banks still are in the old method of physical signatures. Now, whether UDIN is required for manual signing as well as digital signature? Yes, for both types of signatures, UDIN is required. The next question deals with whether separate UDIN would be required by joint auditors. The answer is yes. all the signing auditors have to obtain UDINs separately and mention their UDINs individually on the reports signed by them. However, what the auditors can do is they can use the same or different keywords or figures while generating their individual UDINs. Now, one item is left for us, that is with regard to the tax audit. What we'll do is we'll once again log into this website and check as to how UDIN is to be generated for the tax audit report. Let me give the captcha 24481. We are in. Now, previously for LFAR and certificates, we have selected audit and assurance function. Now for a tax audit, you have to select GST and tax audit. And the form you have to go to what you call this 44ABA of the IT Act. Of course, it is depending upon the turnover, etc. like that. Now give the date and give the items appearing here. Okay, that is how you have to generate UDIN for audit of a branch of a banking company. And that's all for now, and thanks for watching.